As Christians, once that happened, it ain't all roses and everything. I tell the story, I think in October 79, I came to Christ. I was at church trying to meet girls, and this Baptist preacher told me about Jesus. And I remember thinking, I don't want to meet him unless he's got a daughter. So like I said, you can't say amen, say amen. So, but you see, once if a person doesn't know Jesus, he had no problem doing crazy stuff like that. So this guy told me about Jesus. Nice Baptist preacher, James Kelly, I still remember him. And he said, well, look, brother, here's what you do. All that stuff about speaking in tongues and baptism in the Holy Spirit, don't get into that. All you do is get saved, witness to people, and wait for Jesus to come back. Well, when he mentioned that about baptism and the Holy Spirit, that pricked my interest. I'm thinking, well, I wonder what he's talking about there.
Yeah.
And so I said, hey, I want to find out what it's all about. But then I also found out something else, that we as Christians are in a war.
Yeah.
When I came to Christ, I thought it was good. You know, I know that the birds sang sweeter, the sun shone brighter, and the world was a safer place.
Yes.
But what happened is that it dawned on me. The enemy had been bothering me up until then. In fact, you know, I was in the pen. And so what happened was, it dawned on me that I am being attacked. I didn't know what it was, but I'm being attacked. Didn't know the word of God and all that. And so I had a problem because I didn't know that I was in a battle.
Right.
I didn't know anything about how to use the word of God.
Amen.
Sadly, today many people, many of us have that same issue. And what I want to do right now is kind of take a pause. And I would like my wonderful wife of coming up on 24 years, April 4th, to come up and talk a little bit about that aspect of the Word of God.
Amen.
Come on up, sweetheart.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, my love. Appreciate you so much. I love her in the Word of God.
Amen.
And speaking of
delivery,
he'll be back.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is just his bride's time.
Yeah.
So, speaking of the Word of God, I was so blessed last Sunday when we walked through the door. It was Terry who handed us, coming through the door as guests, the Word of God.
Praise
this
God.
Is you, church,
praise
sowing
God.
The Word of God
praise
in
God.
People who walk in to celebrate Jesus with
praise
you.
God.
The first scripture is Matthew 7, verse 8.
Yes.
For everyone who asks, what happens? They receive. Anyone who seeks,
finds.
You find.
Yes.
And when you knock, that door is open
yes.
unto you.
Amen.
So I want to go through one of my favorite scriptures, but before I do, I want to thank a couple guests who are here.
Amen.
And we were talking about on the 14th, on Valentine's Day, your
yes.
church is going to do something amazing.
Yes.
You guys are going to have a wedding. So I just happened to look over at my awesome friend, who was a pastor at the time, Pastor Coleman Jarrell, who married Mel and I almost 24 years ago.
Wow.
And so welcome, Pastor Coleman.
Amen.
I appreciate you so much. And then my stepdad, John Davis, his
yes.
birthday today, and my beautiful mommy.
Yes.
My mommy was the matron of honor in that wedding.
Wow.
So when you said that word wedding, I just thought, how apropos to have them here as guests today in celebration. So one of my favorite things to do is to declare the Word of God over situations.
Yes.
One of my favorite chapters in the entire Bible is Psalm 91.
Yes.
God's spirit of protection,
yes.
protection upon us as believers.
Yes.
So as I was praying which scriptures to share, because there's so many awesome ones that we can stand on,
yes.
but God really directed me, because I was praying for a family in your congregation. You know, that family took a road trip the last couple days.
Yeah.
And on Friday, the daughter was interviewed at Oral Roberts University.
Oh,
and so as I'm going through my file of scriptures, well, guess what I come upon? I come upon Psalm 91, and the declaration is printed from Oral Roberts University.
Oh,
and that's what I'm praying over a family from your congregation who's traveling back today.
My God.
But I thought, oh, yes. God, I love the way that you work and that you just make things fit together so beautifully.
Yes.
So what I'm going to do, I used to be a pre-K teacher, so I'm going to have everyone stand up. I know you guys feel like you're getting some aerobic points. Well, that's what happened when we were at Oral Roberts University. You got aerobic points.
Let's do it.
So, but this is Psalm 91, and the way it is printed out is as a declaration. So I'm going to ask you first to receive from the Lord by opening both hands, and I'm going to present a prayer and a declaration, and then we're going to do a little bit of action words.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we make this declaration of faith.
Yes.
We believe that you are giving us your peace.
Amen.
The peace that passes understanding.
Amen.
For you are a God who does not change.
Amen.
Therefore, we declare with total trust and confidence. Now, this is the time that you get to declare out of your mouth. Because what has God given you? He's given you words of life to speak out of your mouth.
Yes.
Those words are powerful and transforming.
Yes.
And so together, we're just going to join.
Yes.
And this is just a couple phrases, but it wraps up the entire chapter of Psalm 91 beautifully.
Hallelujah.
Now, I want to show you a couple things.
Hallelujah.
When I say I, you can point to yourself to declare
I.
And then when I say you, meaning God, you can point up to the heavens and say God. So here we go. Just about 10 declarations of faith that are going to sum up Psalm 91.
Amen.
I am dwelling in the secret place,
in the secret place
of the Most High God.
I am abiding
under the shadow
of the Almighty.
You are
my fortress.
You are
my refuge.
In you
God
do I trust. You cover me
with your feathers.
I will not
live in fear.
The wicked will
get their reward.
The angels are
watching over me
and keeping me
in all my ways.
Because I
have known your way.
You are delivering
me from trouble.
You are my salvation. So I just encourage you to utilize the Word of God, because you have the power of life to speak over your situations and your circumstances. Amen. And by the way, when you say amen, you are saying so be it. You're coming into agreement. So you want to make sure and say amen at the right time. So here we go. I get to hand the mic back over to Pastor Mel Waters,
hallelujah,
my handsome hubby of almost 24 years.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, sweetheart.
Praise the Lord. How beautiful.
Hallelujah. That is, and we taught our boys to speak. You may be seated.
Hallelujah.
We taught our boys to speak the Word of God. One situation I remember, Matt was my oldest. He was about 7 or 8 years old.
Hallelujah.
I went to pick him up one night from aerobics, and I said, Matt, what's the matter? You're not saying anything. He said, Dad, those boys were mean to me in class tonight. I'm thinking, oh boy, now we're going to get kicked out of aerobics. I said, what happened? He said, he couldn't do the tumbles well. And I said, well, what did you do? He said, Dad, they bothered me, and I wanted to get them back. I said, well, what did you do? He said, I remembered from reading, we used to take our boys through the Proverbs, that the word says that a righteous man overlooks an insult. In other words, for a certain time we taught our boys the Word of God, it was just like memory stuff. But then we got to a point where we taught them to apply it.
Right.
Okay. Why does it need to be applied? Going back to Agents of Change. Because we are in, believe it or not, a war, and we're part of the army of God.
Amen.
So you've got the Word of God that, that Betsy so eloquently talked about there.
Yeah.
But also you have something else. And those are called, when you come to Christ, and this Baptist guy didn't tell me about that. I don't know why. But you have spiritual gifts.
Yeah.
So let's look, turn with me real quick to 1 Corinthians 12. I want to read some introduction to spiritual gifts here. It says, now about spiritual gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. Now about spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I tell you that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed, or no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. Let's look at verse 4. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but the same God works all of them in all men. Now, I'm giving you some homework this week. I want you to read the rest of 1 Corinthians 12. This is kind of whet your appetite a little bit. I want you to read that about spiritual gifts. You're in this army. God doesn't send you out to battle with nothing. He's giving you gifts. He's giving you the Word of God, which is like a sword. Remember when Jesus spoke to, when the man spoke to Jesus, when the enemy of our soul spoke to Jesus and wanted him to bow down, what did Jesus say? It is written. It is written. So if you don't know what's written, you don't, see, the way I look at it, it's like the Word of God is like bullets in a magazine. Many of you have a Quran, it's in a clip, okay? But the Word of God is to be used by the wisdom of God for that particular situation. Because we are in perilous times.
Yeah.
And without the Word of God and these gifts, you're going to be in a situation where the Word says this. It says the weapons of our warfare are not
carnal,
but mighty through
God
for the pulling down of
strongholds.
What is a stronghold? In the spiritual, well, in a natural sense, a stronghold is like bad guys get up on a hill or just shoot at the good guys down there. But a stronghold in a spiritual sense are ideas and high and lofty things that exalt themselves against God.
Yeah.
The reality of it is our education system creates one of the biggest strongholds that we as a country have. Because things that once were looked, when I was a kid, for example, what was moral and what was legal was on the same tracks.
Uh-huh.
And I was telling them last week, the sheriff of our county could come to your house, knock on the door, and ask to see your marriage license. And if you didn't have one, he could tell one of the people to leave. You can imagine how much people would laugh if somebody tried that now? But growing up as a kid, that was the world that I grew up in. What was legal and what was moral were on the same track, but no longer. I'm embarrassed to say this, but probably 60 to 70% of the couples that come in for premarital are either living together or sleeping together.
Right.
And here's what I tell them. It don't bother me that they're sleeping together. What bothers me is what they do when they're awake. So here's what happens here. You caught that. Okay. So here's what I'm talking about. I'm not trying to slam anybody, but what I'm saying is this. The Bible says that Romans 14, 12, every man will give an account of himself to God. If you know someone that's doing something that is taking them away from God, you're not being their friend if you refuse to tell them. When was the last, I'll just lay it out here. I very seldom hear sermons about hell.
Yeah.
Because that don't, you know, my professor in seminary said you got to tiptoe through the tithers. So that don't, you know, bring out much hallelujah, glory to God stuff. But the reality of it is this. Without Christ, a person is hopelessly lost. And unless we get to the point that we will tell them the truth, we're not their friend.
Try mine.